Live from California in the springtime. Unrehearsed, spontaneous, and who knows, I may get an interruption at some point. Have to leave the set and come back. But we keep taping, right? This is all spontaneous. This is happening in the now. Beautiful, gorgeous spring day. I'm actually wearing shorts and jogging shoes, and it's like, okay, getting into it. Wow. I'm going to make some adjustments here at some point. Every day, it's like I'm a different being, so to speak. Yeah, it's extraordinary. Now, this may make it difficult for the viewer, because what we're looking for is stability. But what kind of stability are we looking for? We're looking to stabilize hallucination, actually. This is getting more and more clear to me. Last night I had a dream, extraordinary dream. We were working out and we were going on a run or something, or getting ready to go on a run. And I'm in workout mode these days, which is great. I feel like Laird Hamilton a little bit, actually. Yeah. And in this dream, I went through this gate, and I looked back, and there was this huge tiger there, and the tiger was prowling around. I said, oh my gosh, I hope the tiger doesn't see me, but for sure it will. I'm doomed. I was thinking, what do I do? And then suddenly, get this, suddenly I says, why don't I put this on pause, and I'll handle this in a different episode. Get that? Have you ever done that in a dream? And say, you know what? That's the end of this episode. And next week we'll continue on with this next week in another episode. So I just paused it. And poof, gone. Tiger gone. Everything gone. I switched over to some other, just transported in a dream to some other situation. But then I was thinking like, huh. What do I do about that tiger? It's still there, but I put it on pause. So have you ever paused your dream, consciously paused it? Maybe the tiger's pause gave me a clue there, right? Put it on pause. The big pause, of course, tigers are known for their huge paws. Put it on pause. Then, later on, I'm walking in the dream again, walking somewhere. We're still in workout mode in the hills somewhere. And suddenly this tiger's like right beside me. It's coming up towards me. But I didn't even have time to react to it. It was just right there. It was walking up. It's like, but before any fear could enter me, the tiger looked at me and like was so friendly. Like a dog, friendlier than a dog, and it was just coming up to me just to say hello, and sort of put his head on my hand there like that, and then I said, oh my gosh, it's so friendly, and so I just patted its head, said hello, nice to see you, and it was just like a wonderful, wonderful friendly cat, and I said, Tiger, how is this possible? And the tiger said, well, I grew up in this wonderful situation. It was where I was exposed to all this super positivity and kindness and compassion. And so I was just like super fortunate. And so I'm completely used to being around people, and I'm totally civilized. And it's a dharmic tiger. The tiger is like totally dharmic, totally mellow, totally gentle, totally wise, and it's not dangerous in the slightest bit. There's no wildness in it at all. I said, oh my gosh, the tiger's not going to eat me. I have a dharmic tiger. So, now, last night, prior to going to bed, I saw this picture on Facebook. It was a drawing. And it was really the most disturbing drawing I've ever seen in my life. And I was trying to get past the disturbance of it. It was the most disturbing piece of art I have ever seen. And it caused this feeling in me of, bad feeling, really bad feeling. So I was trying to say, well, I can get through this. I was studying it intently so I could just have this breakthrough, but I couldn't make a breakthrough with it. It was so disturbing. God, I can't even describe it to you how disturbing it was. I've never seen anything like it. So I went to bed in that way. I woke up in the morning, it was still disturbing me. And so I said, what do I do? Well, being an apex yogin, I have confidence, right? That it's... And I said, it's not my problem. I'll give it to the guru. I'll give it to the guru. Give it to Longchenpa. And then I began realizing, hey, I can give this to Longchenpa. I can give this. I can give this. And I began emptying out the eye. Emptying out the eye. I said, give everything to the guru. So I began doing that in my mind. I says, here, this is yours. Here, this is yours. And I just gave away everything. And so the eye was just like this hollow shell, just a shell, a globe, like a lantern or something, just a thin paper lantern. And there's nothing inside. Very thin, just empty inside. And I gave everything to the guru. Says, here, all credits, all troubles, everything, it's yours. I know you have the answer. And so I refused to answer anything myself. I refused to have any answers. I gave all questions, all situations, all potential, hey, I got the answer, you know, to the guru. He says, the guru knows everything. The guru has all answers. I don't have any answers. Gave it all to the guru. Guru yoga, huh? Amazing. So I didn't have to figure that drawing out. I didn't have to resolve it. I gave it to the guru to resolve. So gave everything to the guru. And then see what the guru gives you back. This is guru yoga, surrender yoga, guru yoga. But it's part of apex yoga. But in apex yoga, we introduce something more advanced than what we've had before, really. It is very, very, very amazing and helpful. And what we do is we introduce the wow. Okay, apex yoga, wow. And the wow is like a third self, so to speak. We have what we call the I, and we have what we call the inner self, the inner guru. But we're introducing this bridge between the two called wow, a bridge self. And this bridge self isn't empty. It's full of the wow. It's full of wow. But just that. It is just that. It's a one-trick pony. But it's full of that. Wow. Wow, wow, wow. It's just the wow self. The wow self. No answers, no conclusions, no questions, no analysis, no intelligence, no this, no that. Just, but full of wow. So I am the wow self. I am wow. And by having this wow self, we're able to empty out the eye, empty it out, and see it as totally empty. And yet we're still full. We're still full of wow. And wow doesn't have any definition. The definition of wow is wow. So this is this amazing development, you know, here in spiritual understanding and effectiveness and skillful means, dharmic advancement here. So I was looking at the eye, and the eye was empty, all completely emptied out. Gave it all the content of the eye, gave it to the guru. And yet I was still looking at it and just saying, wow. So there's this other self that's not the guru either, right? The witness self, some call it what the witness, but that's just sort of a, that's too empty of itself. But we're full of wow. I feel very functional, even though the I is emptied out. Now, with this came a great recognition, clarity about what is this I? You know, this is baffling everyone throughout history. And the I is really just Spirit's attempt to stabilize hallucination. And Spirit is so desperate to stabilize hallucination, it imagined there's some capacity to do this, and it calls it the I, that there's this hallucination stabilizer that's able to do this, and we call this the I. But it still isn't stable, so we say that the I is evolving, that it's growing, it's developing, it's learning how to do it. And that's what we call the I. But hallucination cannot be stabilized. And so this is, the I is just wishful thinking, actually, on our part of Spirit. We're Spirit. It's simply wishful thinking. It's hoping that there's an I that can stabilize hallucination, but there isn't. So when we look at what we think is the I, it's full of all this struggle and effort and attempts, and there's all this going on, this activity going on. And we think that is coming from some identity. It's not. It's just all this effort going on, dream effort, how to stabilize hallucination. But we're assuming that there's someone there who's going to actually do it. But Spirit can't do it. Spirit says, wow, I'm mind. I can't stabilize hallucination. In an instant, I can change my mind about it. So I have to have something that knows how to prevent me from changing my mind, that has the capacity to block that. So Spirit has imagined a self, some capability, a capability to freeze it, to lock it into hallucination so it can't change its mind, decide, oh, this instant, I don't want to hallucinate anymore. But there isn't any such capability at all. So I means the imaginary capability to lock hallucination in place, to lock our freedom, the freedom of mind. And there is no such capability at all. So there really isn't any I. There never will be any I. And yet, we've believed in it so much, so we're afraid to just, you know, let go of that. So see it as this empty globe, like a lantern. I was in a store yesterday, and there was this white lantern. And I got this idea of a lantern. Sometimes you see the Japanese lanterns, these very, what is it, rice paper, just really, really thin paper. And they almost float. They're so light. And it's just this empty globe. Empty lantern, just a beautiful, thin, almost transparent, empty lantern with nothing inside at all. But it still has this, you know, just the form is just this round lantern. So, yeah. And it's not doing anything. It's just hanging there. It's just floating in front of you. That's all that it is. Just empty. See it as empty. But you are full of wow, okay? Full of wow. You've given all the efforts, learning, everything that we thought the I was doing, we gave it all to the guru. All to the guru. Says, here, guru, this is all yours. Do with it whatever you want to do. It's yours. I release it. I am no longer interested in any of that. But now we identify as the wow. I am the wow. So it's like an intermediate identity between imaginary identity and true identity. Okay, the I is imaginary identity, hoping that we can construct some identity that is Spirit, not free, you know, locked in place with hallucinating. We're hallucinating the absence of God is what we're doing. Spirit's doing that to try and imagine that it can be greater than God. So I'm seeing Apex Yoga is this super skillful means here, actually. Eventually it will catch on. It's not catching on yet. because we're not quite sure what it is yet. Okay. But it's arriving. It's arriving. My back's hurting because I swang a golf club too many times. I realized that's stupid. How many times do you swing the driver on a golf course? 14 times. You know, 14 times. And that's over a space of 4 hours. I must have swung it, you know, 50 times or something, one after the other, as hard as I could. You never do that on a golf course. What am I thinking? Stupid. You swing it, and then 15 minutes later, you might swing it one time again, and 15 minutes later, once again. That's actually how it goes. You don't do 25 swings in 5 minutes or something, you know. No wonder why my back is sore. So, I'm not going to do that again. But I realized this morning, it was brought through to me. In the dream, I needed to go running or jogging. I can't really run because my knee still hurts. But I'm jogging on the trampoline. And the legs are so important. The legs are the shock absorbers. The legs are shock absorbers. And I wasn't using my legs enough, springy. They weren't springy enough. Really springy legs are important. So that I'm working on the trampoline to strengthen the overall springiness of my legs. And it's working. It's working. I can feel it. It's going to work. It's just a matter of doing it. I committed to say I'm going to do this at least for up to March 18th, and you know, give it a go up to that point. That's sort of a March 18th is sort of a date I've set to be spry, to ready to spring into spring, because it's right before spring, isn't it? 21st. So I'm doing it. I'm doing it. I'm doing 5 minutes at a time. I tried 15 minutes, my leg got a little sore. So I said, let's try 5 minutes, maybe a couple times a day. Maybe 2 times a day, and then maybe up to 3 times a day. And I noticed when I'm walking, I'm bouncing around. And I said, oh, this is good. This is good. I feel bouncy and springy. Of course, the legs are tired because I'm pushing it and working out in various ways to make it really feel. I can feel it, like, oh my gosh, this is really getting me. But I'm doing it. And there's a big difference between doing it and thinking about doing it. I read in this book that you're supposed to put a pinch of salt in your water so it's absorbed by your body. So this morning I was going to drink some water. I said, wait a minute. Should I go do that and try it? I'm lazy. I don't feel it. Okay. All right. Just push myself up. I did it. And I found the problem is it doesn't taste so good. That's why they have those flavored electrolyte tabs. But that's expensive. Maybe I could break it up and put like a quarter of one in or something like that. Why not? I'll try that. But the salt and water, you know, doesn't. That's the reason why we don't drink brackish water. It doesn't taste good. But at least I did it. I got up and did it. And there's a huge difference between actually doing something and not doing it. And for most of us, our entire lives, when we reach the time to depart, drop the body, at least this episode of the I, trying to stabilize hallucination. We say, okay, I didn't quite do it, but I'll have to try again in the next episode. We haven't ever done anything in terms of being liberated. We've only thought about it. And this is, for most of my life, I only thought about it. And there's a reason why, is because, and we have to forgive ourselves for this so we can really start doing something about it, actually. And the reason why we're so stuck, especially in the West, is because of the massive availability of material now, spiritual material. You see, in the past, this wasn't the case at all. You had a guru, the guru gave you specific instruction, and that was it. You didn't have books circulating all over the place, actually. Most of the population of the world didn't have any books at all because it was all done by hand. Or a lot of it was oral transmission, actually, throughout history. Is you had to go to a guru, and the guru had memorized the teachings and would give you oral transmissions of what the teachings were. There's nothing to read. Okay. Nothing to read. And now we're getting, like, completely inundated through books, now the internet, from all these different traditions all over the world, and all these different teachings from all these different gurus and teachers, and it's all suddenly available. And so we're like saying, oh my gosh, I have to sort through all of this, and I have to figure out what's the best, like that. This is a killer. And I did all this. I had to do all of it. I felt I had to sort it through. And it was just the most horrendously difficult thing imaginable. I survived it. Not really survived it. I just, somehow, I'm still here. But it was horrible. And we're all stuck in that. So many are stuck in that. Is that, and when you're sorting through it all, you're not doing any of it. And we have too much to sort through. We have like a trillion times more than anybody in history before has had, really. It's almost undoable. But I just worked at it round the clock, year after year after year after year. And I'm still, you know, doing some of it. But mostly it's all sorted out. And it's, you know, it's just so I can get to the doing of it. You know, so this is the problem that we've had in the West. We're not. In modern age, we're not inferior. It seems that way. We're overwhelmed. We're overwhelmed. So we have got this false inferiority complex in terms of the spiritual path, thinking that, you know, we're not good at it. No, we're overwhelmed, trying to sort through, you know, all this different advice from every possible angle. Where, again, in the past, These were just given to the devotees who already had the bodhicitta or the grace to actually practice. So they weren't sorting through. They were practicing. These were not transmissions that were given to people who were not ready to practice at all. So, but you dump all of this advice and practices out into the world in books everywhere. And you just go online, you can see there's 1,000 books in every direction. Okay, every direction. That never happened in the past at all. Never happened. And again, we may not be ready to practice, or we're just feebly ready to just begin a little bit. In the past, that person would, if you're ready to begin, you would have a guru, a mentor, and they would take you step by step, giving you a little bit at a time, like eating a middle meal, like a baby food, and build up your capacity to practice better and better and better and better. You didn't have all this extraneous teaching bouncing around at all. Not at all. So it's become almost an impossibility now in the world. Is people are just lost in a whirlwind, a spiritual whirlwind. And fortunately, I'm not. I have a mentor. I have a teaching. And I actually do it to some extent. I could do it a heck of a lot better if circumstances were different, but I'm still, you know, in this world, you're still buffeted because everyone I come across is just being in this whirlwind. I can't get them out of it. They don't know, you know, there's just too much stuff. So wait a minute, there's like 1,000 other things I've got to read about first. We're like that, right? So yeah, this sounds good, but this over here sounds good, and this good, and there's these 100 teachers here and 100 teachers here. They all have different teachings, and I got to see what they're saying too. And so we're caught in the intellect of analysis and sorting out instead of emptying everything to the guru. And so we lack confidence because we're overwhelmed, absolutely overwhelmed. This is why I say the Dharma Kings are necessary right now, for people to say, okay, this is it. I'm not going to worry about any of the other stuff. This is it. This is it. So I say, for me, Apex Yoga is it. This is it. Longchenpa is a Dharma King. He's saying, this is it, okay? And it is. It is. It's the Apex approach, which dispenses with all graduated approaches, so to speak. And it incorporates them all. Everything's incorporated, but with great simplicity, great simplicity. And we introduce this wow factor, which stabilizes it all. So we're stable, but we're not trying to stabilize hallucination. Because wow is just this very indeterminate abstractness. Okay, just abstractness. We don't try to define what it is. But we feel it. We feel that this, like, wow. You know, it feels, it. My expectations have been exceeded, and I don't even know how much they've been exceeded by. It's kind of like that. I can't, there's no way I can determine how far my expectations have been exceeded. So I'll just say, wow. That's it. But I feel stable in the wow. It's a stabilizer. It's, and that's what we need in the world. Almost nobody I come across is stable. In fact, maybe no one. There's some that are they're getting there, right? They're getting there. They're feeling, and those are the ones that respond to this wow. They realize, hey, wait, you know, maybe this will be like the stabilizer that I need. Wow. My expectations have just been exceeded in all directions. See, this is what the wow means. In all directions, 360 degree wow. Just exceeded beyond anything that I can sort out or analyze at all. But that's okay, because I've got this one definition for what's happened, which is wow. Which is wow. Apex yoga, wow. Apex yoga, wow. We're already there, but we're still, you know, the shock of exceeding our expectations in every direction beyond measure is that shock. We have to deal with that shock so we don't panic. So we need to come out of this inferiority complex that we have. If you're caught up in materialism excessively, now, we live in a material age, okay? So we don't need to rebel against that. We just have to make sure that we're putting, you know, the Dharma first in our lives. You know, it's okay to look contemporary. Well, that's okay. It's just the world we live in. Just like if you lived in the past in a more austere age, it would have been bizarre to be non-austere, you know? And if you try to rebel against that, you'd stick, I'd say, what is that? So we don't need to be rebels, but we need to be apex yogins. Okay, apex yogins. So I'm not out there, like, I'm running barefoot. You know, I got jogging shoes. And it's okay if to stay with the fashion, if you want to stay with the fashion. I got this bright orange shirt. That's the fashion. Everyone's wearing lime green and, you know, electric orange. Everybody, they're everywhere in the stores. That's, you know, the fashion of the time. So I said, okay, I'll get this one electric orange shirt and actually have this lime green hat. So there you go. I'm in fashion. Just like that. Got it on sale. Both of them. Really, really good. I think I got this like almost for a third of the price. And this one was, I don't know if it was discount. It was cheap. Cheap. Just a t-shirt. So now I feel like, okay, I'm in fashion. Okay. So that's fine. That's fine. That's not going to trip you up. It's just like in the springtime, you know, you're not wearing winter clothes, okay? Or in the summer, you're not wearing winter clothes. Yeah, okay, if it's summer, you know, wear summer clothes, that's fine. But keep the practice and the attention and the effort, you know, very austere, very disciplined, very focused, and very desperate, actually. Because we have gotten in trouble because... What's this? Because of this being inundated. Now, the Tibetans, see, they said they didn't want to give out all this information because they understood that the problems it would give rise to. We'd be inundated. That certainly has happened. We've been inundated from every direction. The affluence of being able to afford to order any book we want. I mean, a lot of people just have. I used to have so many books. It took years to get rid of them. I gave them all away. Boxes after boxes after boxes. Oh, so many trips. I just had, all these spiritual books, so many, a huge spiritual library. I gave it all away. All that was very difficult. I said, "This is killing me. I'll never succeed like this." So now I don't have a library at all. I just have, A Course in Miracles, Journey Beyond Words, Spaciousness, and You Are the Universe by Murray Watts. I believe that's it. And before, I didn't have any book at all. Nothing. I went for a long period of time. I had zero books. Zero. I think, and then finally, I got A Course in Miracles again. I gave away my Course in Miracles. I said, I got to get away from words. And so I have it now. Occasionally, I look at it. Same with Journey Beyond Words and Spaciousness. Occasionally, I'll look at it just to get a little, if I feel stuck, it'll get me going. Yeah, but not that often. Because the inner play is more apparent than words. Really, it's much more compelling. It's much more compelling than reading a book, which requires sort of sorting through at a very mundane level, and that can easily lead to more sorting and more sorting and more sorting. It doesn't really, not very helpful. Now, so the world is an insane asylum because it's all this wishful thinking that there's some personas, some entity, some identity capable of locking freedom in place. And so this is represented as people. And we think, we're the heroes, spiritual heroes. I mean, people think they're spiritual heroes, and we're here. God wants us to accomplish this. But really, it's spirit that is wishing that we can accomplish this. Now, God didn't make bodies or persons or personalities at all. God made spirit, formless spirit. God does not make form. Okay, it's formlessness, formlessness, ideas, essence, essence, freedom. Love is really perfect freedom. And we are imagining time, space, process, and form as a way to try and freeze our freedom. To freeze our freedom. So hallucinating the absence of God seems stable. And we think that that's nirvana, that's happiness, that's our paradise. If we can just stabilize hallucination, then we think this discontinuity dread that we might drop hallucination the next instant will be gone. And then our fear will be gone. But it's impossible. So our fear isn't gone. It's never gone. As long as we're hallucinating, the continuity fear is not going to be gone at all. We just try to bury it, try to split our mind, try all these different defenses. But we're absolutely free, so we're free any instant to change our experiencing, which means any instant at all, we can choose not to hallucinate the absence of God. And it will always be that way. So it's completely futile. What trying to freeze freedom in place is completely futile. Totally futile. So the world, everything we've done, much ado about nothing, has no value to us ultimately at all, because it doesn't work at all. So the only thing to do is to actually give up hallucinating. Since we can't hallucinate the absence of God without feeling terrible, this terrible insecurity, that will always accompany it, always. Give it up. If we want to be really happy, we'll have to give it up. But again, giving up is fraught with insecurity. Very, very much so. So having this intermediate identity of wow is wonderful. Wow is wonderful. I'm the original apex wow yogin. The alpha apex. Wow, Yogan, pioneering this approach. And we can rest in the wow, we feel fine. It's not a problem. We still feel this vague sense of there's something, some identity, but it's not definable. It's not really definable because it's 360 degrees exceeding all expectations, immeasurably so. But at the center of it is this wow, this feeling of wow. It says we don't try to take the measure of it. It feels very stable. Of course, as soon as we try to take the measure of it, there's going to be a feeling of you know, lack of smoothness, trying to sort out, trying to figure out all the, you know, that kicks in, the whole analytical sorting it out mind, sorting it out, nuancing it out, you know, intellect and emotions, that's the same delusional construct in emotions and intellect. It's the same. It's trying to sort it out. Different styles of sorting out. But the wow, there's nothing to sort out. It's just wow. That's all there is to it. It's immeasurable in all directions. 360 degree immeasurableness. Wow. This blocks panic. It blocks panic. It blocks trying to do the impossible. Trying to stabilize hallucination. So when recognition dawns, just stay with the wow. Say wow. Don't grab at it. Don't try to get a hold of it or measure it. Just say, wow, this is exceeding my expectations in all directions. Okay, wow. And so when you get this, when you start getting it, you realize your days of sorting everything out are coming to an end. Because you have this stable intermediate identity. And you can empty out the I. You can empty it out. No answers. No conclusions at all. Zero conclusions. Zero answers. Zero sorting out. Zero knowledge, zero understanding, nothing, all empty, except this thin, just sort of, for a little while, we'll see this very, very thin little lantern there. It's just empty. That helps us recognize the emptiness of what we've done. We've emptied it all out by at least imagining that it has some very thin form that we can see, like a transparent lantern, and it's all empty. It kind of, look at it that way. It's all empty. No answers, no conclusions, no successes, no failures. Nothing is there. Because even if we leave failures there, that still is in contrasting to the belief in successes also. But we've emptied out all successes and all failures. All attempts and all non-attempts is absolutely empty. But the wow is completely full. But it's just full of wow. That's it. Nothing else. It's not full of love. It's not full of this or that. It's just wow. So we seem to be functioning as an I still, very, very stably, even though the I is empty. But we're also able to more and more and more experience the pristine peace of God also. Because we don't have to relate it to the eye, because we see, oh, the eye is empty. Wow. Okay, there's nothing there to respond or react to this piece of God at all. Apex yoga. Wow. It's really tremendous. It's really tremendous. Got my morning smoothie. I didn't put the kale in it. Maybe I should put the kale in it now. Yeah. I'm really crunching the kale every day. My body type has changed. It's changed, actually. I recognize it. It's stronger. Yeah. Not just stronger, but. I sort of feel more athletic. Sort of, I got that more muscular, more muscular, more athletic. It's like, huh, different feel. And balance. This time I'm working on the trampoline to balance out the upper and the lower and the core, all as just one, all as one. And the springiness of the legs really helps that. An athlete, they just sort of they move as one, like a tiger. You know, the tiger is just supple tiger, moving just all as a flow, but still, you know, strong, quick, agile, balanced, all this. There's not one part of the tiger that's like all pumped up. It's all it works in harmony. So that's what I'm trying to do. And doing it. And there's the doing it. That's the difficult part. So don't get down on yourself if you're not doing it. That's the most difficult, to actually start doing it, because we think, well, if we do it, we're missing out on everything else. It's paralysis, right? But if I do this, then I'm not doing that. But if I do that, I'm not doing this. And there's like a trillion different things I could do. So I think if I do this, I'll miss out on a trillion different things. And paralysis. Paralysis. Spiritual paralysis is what's... And then that leads to this posing, what's called overconfidence. Oh, I've got my smartphone. I know what I'm doing. I'm doing that. I'm searching. And that becomes then the doing, is I'm just searching for something. I'm not actually doing anything. I'm just searching. Of course, that searching can go on forever. With all the what we have in the world now, we have to recognize the times and realize this is an insane trap, an insanely terrible trap we're in right now. And you should have the fear of God upon you, as far as you've got to back away from that trap. Because the sorting will be endless now. You should look at it and say, oh, this is going to be endless. And crazy. And again, in the past, there wasn't anything like that. Nothing like that. A Tibetan Lama would be able to discern that there's someone in the Shedra, the teaching monasteries. They put the young kids, the most promising, bright young kids, in this teaching monastery. They go up through there, and the Lama can easily tell, you know, that they sort it sorts itself out. And here's one that's really, really bright and very disciplined. And then they say, okay, I'm going to take you. You can see me as your, you can consider me as your Lama. And it may take many years. And they have to begin to this teaching relationship where they get more directly mentored, and the others don't get that direct mentoring, that are not so bright. That's how it worked. And then that one would eventually, they get, you know, more and more information from the guru. But the guru says, don't tell anybody else. Don't tell anybody else, because it'll overwhelm them. That's how it has been throughout history. Whatever the Essenes, you know, the Hindu, you know, gurus, the rishis, all throughout history, whatever traditions there are, the wise ones pass on the wisdom to those up and coming next generationers that have the capability for the wisdom, and they don't pass it on to anyone else. But now it's like total flood of all of this information, total flood everywhere. Everyone has access. And so you get interested and intrigued by the spiritual path. You get buried. You get absolutely buried. And then you go cuckoo in terms of trying to sort it all out, and then feeling like I'm not capable. And then you panic, and then you get fixations because of the panic. And that's what I'm seeing. I'm seeing an insane asylum. Facebook is really an insane asylum, actually. Literally. It's like every... I agree to all the friend requests, but every single one is a mental patient. Almost. But yeah, I mean, let's not even say almost. Everyone, we're all, you know, I'm a recovering mental patient, right? And so we're all either, you know, mental patients or recovering mental patients. We have... You know, we have a psychosis. Everyone does. And so, but most there on Facebook, they don't realize that. And it's full blown. You know, it's like, wow, what can I do? Because they're lost in trying to sort everything out. And I've already done that. I've already been through it all and gradually have been able to find, I had to actually get in to help establish this new yoga, so to speak. When you're working on establishing a new yoga, you have to focus on it. And you cannot be spending your time on all this other stuff. So that's why it's so helpful. Longchamp has been so helpful. He said, would you like to help me out here? And he wants to, he says, I want to establish this new yoga. It's this beautiful, super effectiveness. I want you to help me with this. So I had to then commit to this and stop working on all this other stuff. And you could do the same. You could help me establish Apex Yoga. Wow, Apex Wow Yoga. I can call it Apex Wow Yoga. Actually, I should call it Apex Wow Yoga. That's even better. Apex Wow Yoga. I'm an Apex Wow Yogin. You could help Longchampa and myself establish this. And what this will do is will pull you out of all the sorting. It will pull you out of all this attempt to sort through trillions of bits of information and advice from every possible angle. And you say, well, I don't have to, I'm committed to this, so I cannot, you know, I'm an intensive, means I'm not working on sorting any of this other information out. I have to focus on helping establish Apex Wow Yoga. And you will find this will be the most helpful thing imaginable. Because you'll be practicing Wow, and you'll take the identity of my identity is now not I, but Wow. So it's a golden opportunity. It's a golden opportunity for all of you, actually. It really is. So I'm starting to recognize this. And you don't have the pressure of being the first one, you know. That's a lot of pressure. So I've already done that. I've already done that. Already committed to that. I did because nobody else is doing it. I said, I have to have something like this, or I'm going to fail. So I said, okay, I wish somebody else would do it, but nobody else is doing it. So Longchampa says, will you do it? I said, okay, let's do it. Nothing else to do. What else is there to do? I mean, nothing else works. I'll just waste my life here and fail. Yeah, I can't have that. So, it means doing all this taping every single day. It's constant commitment. But I've been doing that for quite some time, constant commitment. Helping anchor this here. Apex Wow Yoga. I like that. Apex Wow Yoga. That's really cool. Apex Wow Yoga. Apex Wow Yoga. Apex Wow Yoga. Yeah, that's super. Thank you, Longchampa. Wow, I mean, all glory to the guru. All merit and glory to the guru. We give all the merit and the glory and all success to the guru. And let them sort that out. They don't have an issue with that. For them, there's nothing to sort out. You see, it's all one. And Longchampa is so wonderful because he's the one that pioneered, really helped pioneer the Apex approach, radical Dzogchen approach of beyond the graduated paths, beyond graduated paths of sorting stuff out. They said there's nothing to sort out, actually. There's all, the pristine peace of God is already everywhere. And there's nothing you need to do to make it so or to establish it so. And even delusion is that pristine peace of God. And this is the apex perspective from the get-go. Just that. Nothing to sort out. So you can give everything to such a guru because such a guru is totally established in the realization there's nothing to sort out at all. So it's not going to bother them in the slightest bit. Oh, my back. too much. Hopefully, it'll recover. It feels like nothing, and I didn't damage anything. My breathing is still good. I just have to stop that vicious swinging. Too much club there, too much. The strength is there. Why do I have to do it like 50 times? I'm trying to get faster, that's why. But then I realize, you know, I don't have to hit it as hard as I can every single time, necessarily. Sometimes you might want to just, you know, put a nice, you know, medium swing on it. And if the power's there, that may be enough. I mean, it's good to have the strength and speed, but maybe you just want to hit it, on this hole you want to hit it like 280. 280 is good enough. Well, is 280 good enough? Yeah, I get, you know, 280 is pretty good. I mean, if you're playing from the white tees, most holes are like 400 or less from the white tees. You're not going to get a lot of, unless you're playing a monster course. But so hit it 280, you have like 120 or less into the flag. That's a short iron. That's like a 9 iron. An 8 iron, 9 iron for me. Something like that. You know, it's not that far away. So I don't need to hit it 320, because then it would be maybe just a nice sand wedge or something. I mean, that'd be nice too, but 280s probably will work for now. So I mean, just get in that 280 range, which means have something in reserve. You can hit it 300, but that's just all out. But you don't necessarily swing as hard as you can every swing. You swing like about 90%, but that then spares your back. It's when you go all out. That's when you really torque everything severely. But if you just lay off 90% or so, just do that. That's probably a better approach, actually. But I was trying to hit my four wood, like 240 or something. So that's why I was swinging so hard. But it's better to go to a course where you don't have to do that, where you can rely on your driver and just hit it at 90%, and that's actually better. I think. We'll see. Or maybe I can swing hard just, you know, 14 times. Maybe that's also possible. We'll see. Now, it's good to have like a physical goal too, so you don't get pulled in all directions. Apex Yoga, we have a nutritional goal, a physical goal, and a spiritual goal. And it's very like sort of clear and set. So we are not trying to sort everything out. Now, for those who think if they sort everything out, they'll be these geniuses. Well, they'll never sort it all out, actually. And it's all the peace of God already anyway. And if you sort it all out, what are you left with? You still have to practice. And we already have what I consider the best practice here. You know, as good as it gets. I'll put it that way. It's as good as it gets. So what's the point of spending your lifetime sorting it out, just staying busy sorting it out? That's kind of ridiculous, actually. That didn't happen in the past. The success came to those who had a very clear path. The guru says, this is your path. We're working on it every day. And they did that, and boom, they succeeded. That's what succeeds. You're never going to succeed trying to be the master of all different directions and paths and advice. That's not the way. That's not the way at all. And it's all the pristine peace of God anyway. So there's no way you can have more success than someone else. It's impossible. Peace of God rests upon everything equally. It's equally smoothed out. That's the success. The success that comes to us is the same for everyone. And then if you say, well, I'll be able to teach more people that way. No, you just confuse everyone. If you're teaching all different directions, it's very confusing. Because people are very fragile. Otherwise, you wouldn't need the teaching in the first place. So you need to help them stop trying to sort it all out and actually start practicing. Without practicing, success will not come. And if they're trying to sort it out, they're not practicing. So we need to get back to Guru Yoga, Dharma King Guru Yoga, which means the heavyweights say this, you know, this is the approach. Now, Nanda Mahima was not trying to give us all different approaches. She was inspiring each one of us to practice the approach that we have, to practice that approach. So she tried to empower the gurus so we'd be attracted to the spiritual path and then, you know, get a guru and take that approach. Take that approach. Practice it. Actually do it. Actually do it. So I'm actually working out, folks. I mean, I'm not just saying that I'm doing this. I worked out this morning, and I'll probably work out several times today. It's a weekend, and I'm really doing it. I'm simulating paddling by pulling this rubber stretch band from a beam like this, pulling it, and this really simulates paddling. So, you know, getting ready for a surfboard, paddling like this, that's a muscular action that we normally don't do in life at all. That's why when you try to surf, you just can't, your arms just turn into spaghetti. You know, I mean, you can't do it because that paddling motion is just something that's really, we don't do. That's a little different than the swimming motion. It's a little different than the swimming motion. Swimming motion, you're kicking your feet, you know, you're pulling like this. It's a little different. It's a little different because you're lying on a surfboard and your chest is kind of raised. And you're having to dig like this, it's a little different. So even if you're a swimmer, swimming will certainly help, but it's not exactly the same muscle group that's doing it. So I'm not helping people sort it all out. I'm helping them see how to get free of that sorting out effort. It's not necessary. And we've been suckered into this. It's absolutely overwhelmed. We're overwhelmed by it. So just realize there's nothing to be gained in that at all, really. You just need to find, you know, a brilliant, effective approach, and then just do it. And really, it's all about dropping hallucination. No matter what approach you take, what all approaches have to be about, no matter what they are, if they're effective, is you ultimately have to set hallucination down. You have to set hallucinating the absence of God down. Conditioned existence is nothing but hallucinating the absence of God. That's all that's going on. That's all that's going on. That's it. Nothing other than that. So the end result is going to be the same. Absolutely the same. You have to set it down. And when you set it down, you experience the peace of God. Resting upon everything. Saturating everything. Equally. Smoothed out equalness. Intrinsic spaciousness, so to speak. That's the end point of any path. Is the same. So what is this sorting out? You're trying to find one that has a different result? Really, all this sorting out is we're being overwhelmed. We've been overwhelmed. So you have to recognize the problem. We have been completely overwhelmed, and it's not getting any better. It's getting worse and worse and worse. And people are just taking refuge in drugs, sex, drugs, rock and roll, smartphone. You can see they're overwhelmed. They don't have spiritual confidence. This is what I'm seeing. Nobody has spiritual confidence. I have it, and it seems to, you know, like to be an anomaly. People say, you're crazy, something was wrong with you. They don't say that, but they're kind of frightened. It's like seeing a tiger is so confident, you know, and because I have spiritual confidence, because I'm not trying to sort it all out anymore. I'm actually practicing it. When you practice it, you get stronger, so just like I'm feeling physically, I'm feeling, you know, more confidence physically. Just in terms of, hey, I'm actually getting in better shape. There's no question about it. I've even bulked up like 3 pounds. And I do feel bulked up and more, you know, solid and bulked up, so to speak. Oh, but over my real skinny weight was 169. I got down to 169. I felt real skinny. Now I'm up about 3 pounds because I've been eating a lot more, because I've been working out more, and I feel, you know, so it's adding mass, you know, actually muscle mass, actually. And so you just feel different. And it's a sense like, you know what, I am getting somewhere. So we have goals, both nutritional, fitness wise, and spiritual wise. Nutritional goals is ultimately you tend to trend towards, you know, really healthy nutrition. There's a smoothie. What's in this smoothie is fresh squeezed orange juice. It's expensive, yeah. But absolutely freshly squeezed. Right there in the store, so to speak. Yeah, right there. A whole lemon, the juice of a fresh lemon. Fresh organic lemon. Odwalla berry power juice. Berry power drink. Super berry drink. A whole bunch of frozen blueberries and 2 scoops of chocolate protein powder, whey powder. So it's pure whey, chocolate whey protein powder. That's what's in there. Now, I'm going to need to add some kale to that. I'll freshen it up, add some kale, add some water to it, bring it up to full again, and I'll have that throughout the day. So nutritionally, we can go towards less bigger meals, for instance. I don't eat big meals. I sip a little during the day, sip a little. I just sort of sip a little. A lot of fluids. Hydration is very important nutritionally. Hydration, hydrate, hydrate, hydrate. If you're drinking smoothies and keep like filling this up, this half, fill it up with water or some, you know, coconut electrolyte drink or something, whatever, juice. And just keep doing that during the day. Keep diluting it more and just keep drinking during the day. You're getting tremendous hydration. Hydration prevents injury in your muscles, prevents soreness, prevents injury, all this. If you're dehydrated, you're going to feel achy and sore. But if you're really hydrated, well, you're doing fine. But we don't use all these designer, trendy nutrition stuff like creatine and things like that. You know, creatine just helps your muscles absorb, hold more water, so you puff up and you seem to look stronger than you really are. That people do that to look like, oh, I'm really strong. We don't do that stuff. We're not trying to attain artificial some result like that. But you can have some vitamin C, B, you know, whatever, A and D, if you want. But you don't need to go crazy on it. I take a few sometimes, vitamin C and stuff like that, but by and large, not so much. And stay away from all that, you know, just a singular thing that's supposed to, you know, the quasi-steroid stuff, creatine and stuff like that. You have to draw the line somewhere. So it's very important to draw the line. If you don't draw the line, what happens? Sorting out goes on forever, doesn't it? There's constantly new, I mean, the whole fitness nutrition thing is just this massive global obsession. And there's no end to the tweaking that everybody's trying to do. So we want to avoid all that tweaking, all that sorting out. And we just, you know, settle on something very simple. I just do the Nutribullet smoothies and put various stuff in them. I know it's all good, really good food. You know, a lot of nuts, a lot of seeds, pumpkin seeds, hazelnuts, walnuts, pecans, peanut butter, cashews. Peanuts, cashews, so lots of nuts and seeds, and then grains, rice, quinoa, bulgur, millet, you know, whatever. You get these salads that split grain salad and this stuff. Like lots of grains, whole wheat, sprouted wheat, you know, bread with peanut butter and bananas, and so fruit, grains, seeds, nuts. and then protein powder, whey protein powder. And that's my diet. That's my diet. Vegan diet, actually. I guess you could say I'm pretty much vegan. I'm not even eating yogurt right now. But occasionally I eat some yogurt. And occasionally some cheese. But I could actually do without both of those. If I didn't do that, I would be vegan, actually, at this point. As far as I know. Oh, the whey is not vegan. Okay, so I'm not total vegan, but I'm like a cousin, first cousin to being a vegan, actually. Certainly a vegetarian. Yeah, I don't eat eggs anymore. Very little cheese, and actually very little yogurt at this point. And I feel better. I feel great. And I don't like, for some reason, I'd rather drink fruit juice than eat the fruit. I don't know why that is. I'd rather have a smoothie. I could put a banana in a smoothie. I like it better than trying to eat a banana. Or the orange juice better than trying to eat an orange. Because it's messy. You have to eat it all at one time. Whereas a smoothie, you just sip during the day. I just bring it with me, sip a little bit, sip a little bit, sip a little bit. Yeah, I love that. So there's no, I don't sit down to meals at all. So there's an Apex Wild Yogan goal right there nutritionally, is less big meals. Certainly no stimulants at all. No coffee, no tea, no guarana, no energy drinks, none of that. That's absolutely out. Absolutely out. That creates that's trying to help you be more, be more effective in sorting everything out. Say, well, if I just have a bunch of caffeine, I'd be able to be a sorting out fiend. Caffeine is the ego drug, the eye drug. It's trying to make the eye more effective. We think, oh, the only problem is the eye is not freezing mind in place, and so it needs to be more effective. So how can I make it more effective? That's not the path to salvation at all. It's the opposite. It takes you more and more down into this feeling of damnation and doom and depression and despair. And ultimately, the bottom of all that is mental chaos. So that's what happens when you try to take that path all the way and give it the total effort. You end up with mental chaos. You experience but it's really just this play of labels, trying to confuse mind, so mind is frozen in place through confusion, through mental chaos. It's trying to create this confusion that is so complete that the mind then is frozen in place and cannot think to drop hallucination. That's the remedy we try to apply, but even that remedy we realize can be dispensed with in an instant. So the power of the mind is still there. I experienced it. I realized the power of the mind is still there. So it's completely futile. Absolutely futile. Even that doesn't work. And that's the most extreme remedy that there can possibly be. And it didn't work at all. At that point, I realized, okay, this has to be given up. Okay. And then at that instant, the Holy Spirit, I asked for help. The Holy Spirit showed up. The guru, inner guru showed up and said, okay, let's go to work now. I said, okay, there's nothing else to do. Let's go to work. Let's be blue collar. Let's get our lunch pail and just go to work on it every day. You can't really be a white collar worker on a spiritual path. Cannot. You cannot work real hard at it and then take a month vacation or 3 week vacation. Like white collar people. They're always taking vacations. This whole area is, high professional white collar area. A lot of weekends the place is like abandoned. They've all gone somewhere. They've all gone somewhere. They can afford to. They can afford plane flight and hotel and food and the bills because they're white collar. They have a lot of disposable income. So they take vacations all the time. All the time. In a year they might take, 10 different vacations possible? Something like that or more. It's just part of constant part of their life. So they take breaks all the time. You can't do that on the spiritual path. You cannot say, I'm going to take 10 days off and do that consistently like that? No way. So the people I work with, they work 6-7 days a week. They're blue collar labor types, and for them, there's no question of like, I'm going to take some. A lot of people I work with, they've never even had a vacation. I say, are you going to have a vacation someday? So I don't know. Maybe they go to like Disneyland for one day, or so they drive down and then one day and drive back or something. That's their vacation for their life. I mean, they just work, 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 work. That's it. So you really have to be blue collar on the spiritual path, not white collar at all. And so fortunately, I've been able to get into this not having any money. I can't go anywhere. And then hanging out with blue collar people constantly, it's just, you know, they don't even talk about it. So you know, you didn't, the issue of like where you go and that never arises, or when's your vacation, or what are you going to do? No, it never arises, so I never think about it. I don't think about it so much. Really, if you, white collar, they're always planning their next vacation. They're always planning their next vacation. You have to understand this. So if you're white collar on the spiritual path, you're never even taking the path. You're always planning your next vacation from the path. Whereas if you're blue collar, the idea of vacation never even arises from the path. It's today, I'm going to be working at it all day. There's just no question about it. Speaking of that, I think I do need to go to work. Yeah, I need to do some literal blue collar work here today. Oh my gosh, yeah. If my back can handle it, okay, very great. I think I'm going to call it. This has been a really, really great video. And just, we've introduced the Apex Wow Yoga arrives. Very great, that's it.